Dr. Goldin-Meadow is a founding editor of Language, Learning, and Development, and was an associate editor of Cognitive Science, Developmental Psychology, and Gesture. She has served as president of Cognitive Development Society, president of the International Society of Gesture Studies, chair of the Cognitive Science Society, chair of the Section on Linguistics and Language Science of the American Association for the Advancements of Science, as well as a section on psychology. She is currently serving as past president of Association for Psychological Science, or APS. Dr. Goldin-Meadow is also a fellow of APS, APA, Linguistic Society of America, Society of Experimental Psychologists, the American Association for the Advancements of Science, and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. In 2001, Dr. Goldin-Meadow was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship and a James McKean Cattell Fellowship, which led to her two published books entitled Resilience of Language and Hearing Gestures, How Our Hands Help Us Learn. In 2005, she was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and in 2015, she received the William James Award for Lifetime Achievement in Basic Research from APS. Dr. Goldin-Meadow's research has two foci. First, her research focuses on language creation in children who are not exposed to linguistic input, while the second focus of her work is on the gesture we produce while speaking and their impact on thinking. She is the principal investigator of an NICHD-funded project that is now in its 13th year, was a co-principal investigator of the NSF-funded Spatial Intelligence and Learning Center, and is currently serving as co-director of the Center for Gesture, Sign, and Language at the University of Chicago. Today, Dr. Goldin-Meadow will be speaking to us about how our hands can change our minds, the resilience of language and gesture. Please welcome Dr. Susan Goldin-Meadow.
What the Linguistic Society of Paris said was that the society does not accept papers on either the origin of language or the invention of universal language. And they did so because they thought the papers were getting a little boring, that they weren't reaching their mark. There were many of them, and they weren't really making any progress in the study of the evolution and the origin of language. The London Philological Society followed suit in 1872. Now, 150 years later, I have a study that might make these folks change their minds. And I say might because the language that I'm talking about isn't French, which the French clearly aren't going to like, but it isn't even a spoken language. Now, to address this question, I want to go back to the very first study that has been reported on this kind of question. And this is described by Herodotus, who's an ancient philosopher. He described a study, an argument between an Egyptian king and a Phrygian king. And what they were arguing about was which was the original language. Now, being kings, the only languages that they considered were Egyptian and Phrygian. But somewhat surprising for kings, they decided to settle this debate not by battle or by edict, but by experiment. So what they did is they took a shepherd and two children, two infants, and they put the infants in the custody of the shepherd and said, go out and care for these children, feed them, clothe them, do whatever you need to keep them alive, and don't say a word to them. So they were without linguistic input for, 18 months, 2 years. The kings came back and they observed the children and they found that the children both produced the word bakos, which means bread in Phrygian. And so the conclusion of the study is that Phrygian is the original language. And needless to say, this study hasn't been replicated a lot of times. Even before the IRB got serious and hard for us, it was hard to get such a study done. However, it turns out that although we can't replicate the study, we can take advantage of an experiment of nature. We can look for kids who just aren't exposed to language, and we can ask whether they can invent, essentially reinvent, language. Okay. Now, the big question, of course, is who isn't exposed to linguistic input? Everybody's exposed. You live in a sea of linguistic input. But it turns out that there are some children who have linguistic input that they can't make use of, and those are deaf children. Children whose hearing losses are so profound and severe that they can't make use of all of the spoken language that surrounds them. Moreover, these children are born to hearing parents, as most deaf children are, and the hearing parents don't know a sign language. So although they could take advantage of a sign language and learn it, they don't have it exposed to them. So what they've got is just their hands. And what happens is that these children turn to gestures to communicate, and we call these gestures home signs. And the question is, how much of home sign has the structure of language? So what I'd like to do first is just give you an example of a home signer. This is a deaf child born to hearing parents in the United States. He's about 3 years, 11 months. He's talking about a shovel stuck in sand. It's a Richard Scarry book, for those of you who know the literature. It's a picture of just the shovel. And he starts gesturing, telling you about how you can shovel. And when you shovel with this thing, he starts talking about the fact that you can do this with snow shovels. So he talks about snow coming down and pulling on your boots and doing it outside, and the shovel's kept downstairs. And it's clearly communication. Okay.
Shovel. Shovel.
In the wintertime.
So this is a child in America, and this isn't unique to America, as you wouldn't be surprised to hear. Here's a deaf child of hearing parents in Taiwan. Same book, chooses a different picture to talk about. It's a picture of a swordfish, and she says the swordfish can pierce you through the heart, and it can make you dead. This turns out to be a gesture, not a sign, a gesture used by Taiwanese hearing people, and it means dead. Pierce you through the heart, make you dead, it has a long nose, and it swims. And just to show you how interactive this stuff is, it really is used for communication. Her hearing sister comes and sits in front of her, and she says, it can pierce you through the heart, and it can make you dead. Okay? And she says it with a little bit more force than is really needed. A lot more force than was really needed. So it is so clear that this is communication. There's no question that these children are trying to communicate with those around them. The big question is whether it's language. Does it have linguistic structure? And I've spent 40 years trying to figure out whether these gestures have the structure of language, and they do. To some extent, there are many properties of language that are found in this system. There, in these gestures, there are properties at the sentence level, at the word level, and in terms of language use. And I'll give you some illustrations of them in the next videos. It doesn't have all of language, doesn't have all of linguistic structure, and that becomes an interesting issue too, which we'll talk about. Okay, so here's an example of a sentence level property. When the kids produce these gestures, they don't just mime eating an apple. What they do is they break the eating event up into components and then string those components together, almost like beads on a string, and those beads are ordered. So for example, what this child is doing is pointing at a snack and then doing an eat gesture and then pointing at me, the eater. So grape or snack, eat, eater. Now notice that's not English order, but it is an order, and it's an order we find in all of his sentences, or most of them. Here he goes. No, he's not gone. Yes, he's gone. Did you see it? We try it again? Okay, let's go to back up. Okay, snack, eat, person, me. Object, action, agent. Okay. And that's the order he uses in most of his sentences. Their word structure, the word level in both cultures, both the Chinese and American culture, invent gestures for particular actions like eat. You would do the same if I asked you to do eat in the American kid. On the other hand, the Chinese kid, he also does this too, but he does something that you probably won't do, but you might not find surprising, which is this. I'm not tall enough for this. Okay. Okay. So, and finally, although I don't think a home signer would ever invent a gesture system if they had nobody to talk to, nobody to communicate with, once having invented a gesture system to talk to somebody else, you can use it to talk to yourself. And that's what these guys are doing, which I think is really pretty impressive. So here's a kid, deaf kid, sitting next to his hearing sister. He's looking for a plastic knife. He gets up, puzzled, looks around, does this sort of wear gesture, this, and then points at himself. But he doesn't look at anybody. He makes no eye contact at all. So take a look. Okay, so he gets up, makes a weird gesture, points at himself, he's looking around, and he has no interest in telling anybody other than himself that he's looking for the knife. Okay, so the question that might be popping into many of your minds is whether these linguistic properties were really invented by the deaf kid. One possibility, a very obvious possibility, is that the children's parents, their hearing parents who gesture all the time, as we all do, might have invented these properties, and then the kids learned from them, which is still pretty impressive, but it's not the same kind of question. Okay. Now, to address this question, I want to talk about two structural properties that we found in home sign, and in particular in Nicaragua. We've been looking in Nicaraguan home sign. One is complex sentence. So a complex sentence has, you look within the bounds of the gestures put together and see how many propositions are produced. And some of them have more than one proposition, as in this next example, where the kid is pointing at a bean. He does a sign for bean. Then he points, so that bean cut. That tomato eat. So both cutting and eating are part of the sentence. So bean cut, bean eat. Bean cut, bean eat. Okay. Complex noun phrases, in contrast, sort of you don't expand the two propositions, but rather you take one argument and expand that. So what the child does is he points at an airplane and he says it's mine and it's over there. So he's sort of saying two things about the airplane. It's my airplane. That's the noun phrase. It's over there. No? Mine? Okay, there it is. So these are really simple structures, but they are structures. And notice that they do have hierarchical structure in each of these. So the question is, did the kids invent this or the parents invent this? So to look at this, we went to Nicaragua, where there are home signers, just like there are all over the world. And we looked at what the hearing parents and children, family members, other hearing family members did with their children. And we analyzed the gestures that these hearing folks produced using exactly the same tools that we used to analyze the deaf kids. Okay, and this is what we found. First, we found that the home signer produced more structured gesture sentences, complex sentences. So what you see here is Nicaragua on the left, United States on the right. Home signers are in red. The hearing family members are in blue. In both cases, the home signers do many more of these things, significantly more of these things, than do their hearing parents. That's true also for complex noun phrases. In fact, it's pretty striking for complex noun phrases. In Nicaragua, the parents do it more. In the United States, the parents never do it. They never, ever essentially point at a cup and do something like this. They'll either point at the cup or do the cup, but they won't combine the two and embed it in a sentence, okay? So, so there's a lot of variability here. It's clear that on average, the kids are producing more than the parents. But maybe it's possible that parents who produce a lot of these things have kids who produce a lot of these things, and parents who produce very few of these things have kids who produce very few of these things. We then expect a nice, neat, linear relationship between what the parents do and what the kids do. So we investigated this by child and by diet, and we found, in fact, that there's no relationship between what the parents did and what the kids did. So here the first, you see for complex sentences, on the x-axis you see the hearing family members, on the y-axis you see the home signers. There's no relationship at all, nothing. And for complex sentences, we find exactly the same thing, which you might have expected because a lot of the parents aren't doing anything at all. So there is no relationship between parent and kid, which suggests that home signers can invent the rudiments of language. That means that people, we can, you could, anybody could, invent the rudiments of language even if you've never been exposed to language. Language doesn't have to be handed down from generation to generation to look like what it does. Okay. So one question, however, is how far a home signer can go toward developing a language. I said that home sign has a lot of the properties of language, but it doesn't have all of the properties. So how are we, and those are interesting, because those are the ones that we can't bring, we people can't bring, or don't bring to the language learning situation. So we've begun to investigate this question in Nicaragua, because I suspect many of you know there's a sign language growing up in Nicaragua. 30 or 40 years ago, home signers who all lived individually in their homes with their hearing family homes were brought together for the very first time, and they got to communicate with each other. So what's interesting about a home signer is that this home signer is producing these structured gestures, and their hearing family members are looking at them and wanting to communicate, and what they do is they talk, and they produce these gestures back, but their gestures are co-speech gestures, and I've just shown you they don't match what the kid does. So the kid is producing but not receiving. On the other hand, when you start putting two home signers together, we have two home signers who are starting to both produce and receive. And they have the possibility of negotiating a shared language. So for the very first time here, we see invention with shared participants. Okay. What's now happening is that those guys, that cohort one, are bringing new people, or new people are entering, new deaf children are entering the community, and they're learning their language from that cohort too. So we have transmission, sort of like the transmission that we have as well, although the language isn't as fabulous. Okay, so what we've tried to do is just to look at a particular property of language over these three language learning possibilities, or language creation possibilities. We've looked at plurals, how you indicate the plural. Now, if I asked you to with your hands, just show me a bunch of cups, you might do just like that, what this guy did. He does bump, 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 bump. But they actually do something else as well that you probably, you won't do them. I know, we've already studied this. You could do something like this, where you sort of do a trill. You do boop, boop, boop. And the thing about this boop, boop, boop is that when they do it, it doesn't matter how many objects are there. They could be two objects, they could be 20 objects, they could be three objects. It just basically means more than one, a bunch. So look at this. Okay, so that's a more, okay. So what we wanted to see was what the distribution of this sort of discrete plural versus this trilled plural was. And we looked at the people's use in two different contexts. In no agent trials, when they're just objects sitting there, and in agent trials, where a person is putting down the object. So the person puts down a bunch of pens. We looked at how these participants described each of these contexts. In the no agent trials, we found no differences among the three groups. They used either the discrete repetition or they used the plural repetition. They all did it. They're all capable of this. And they use them as home signers, NSL1 or NSL2. But it starts getting interesting when we used agent, because now the home signers don't use a form that they could have used. Why not? I don't know why, but they don't use it. And interestingly, even when you have a home signer to share your system with, you still don't use it. So NSL1 doesn't have it either. But what's sort of interesting is that when you start transmitting this language to another person, that's when they start to use this plural for agent trials. So the particular instance doesn't really matter, but what's really interesting here is that it's only when home sign is transmitted to the next generation, when it's learned as opposed to being created, that these particular properties come about. So we have properties now that the home signers bring that are inventable by any of us, and then there are properties that need to be learned by the next generation. Okay. So home sign gives us a window into the properties of language that are so resilient they can be invented by a child. But this progression in Nicaragua, the emergence of a Nicaraguan sign language, or any sign language, this happens all over the world, gives us a window into the factors that make language grow beyond the resilient properties. So language is resilient. When it can't come out of the mouth, it comes out of the hands. But you know what? Gesture is resilient too. The kinds of gestures that we all produce when we're talking, it's not home sign, it's not language per se, but it's resilient and it is informative. So let me give you an example. Everybody gestures. Here's an example of a woman asked to just say how she got from one place to another, and here she goes.
Just tell me everything that will pass as we walk through.
Okay, well, the front door, there's an entryway, and as soon as you enter the front door, you're going to see Dash's shoes on the right on the floor, because they're dirty, and so I don't take them in. Uh-huh. And he'll come in, and, you know, he'll bend down and pick them up in the morning, too, and he wags his tail. He's walking around, he's so funny. And so,
so proud.
So there's nothing unusual about that woman's gestures. But there is something unusual about her that many of you may have noticed. She's blind. That's her seeing eye dog sitting there. And she's blind from birth. She has never, ever seen anybody gesture. Why is she gesturing? How does she know to gesture? But it's just by virtue of talking that her hands come up and start to embellish what she's saying. Everybody gestures, even if they've never seen gesture. So that's interesting. The question is, or the question I was interested in, is whether these gestures are anything more than hand waving. So fine, we wave our hands. Does it mean anything? And the answer is yes, it does. Gestures can reflect what we know, what we speakers know, and it can change what we know. And let me give you a couple of examples. So we started looking at this in an old Piagetian task. Some of you may be familiar with this. Piaget took two rows of checkers, gave them to a child, said, are there the same number of checkers in the top row and the bottom row? And the kid says, yes, great. Then he spreads them out, and he says, okay, are they still the same? And conservers, like you, say yes, but non-conservers say no. Piaget was interested in what they said. I'm really interested in what they gestured. So here's a kid who says and gestures pretty much the same thing. Says they're different because you spreaded them out. And she talks about spreading and she gestures about spreading.
Yes. Do these two rows of checkers have the same number of checkers? No. Which row has more checkers in it? Now, why does it have more checkers in it?
You spread them apart and this one stays like you put them down.
So this child is producing what we've come to call a gesture-speech match. She's talking about the fact that you're spreading, moving it around in both gesture and speech. Compare her to this kid, who is just as much a non-conserver. He says they're different because you moved them, but watch his hands. He does this. That's pretty clever. He's showing the one-to-one correspondence between the two rows.
Do our rows have the same number of checkers in them now? Or why is there a different number on those?
Because you moved them.
So he's produced what we've been calling a gesture-speech mismatch. He talks about moving, but he gestures about one-to-one correspondence. So when we found these mismatching kids, we said, oh, what's going on with them? One possibility is that they actually are in a different cognitive state from kids who are also non-conservers, but are matchers. So to find out, we gave them all instruction in conservation, and we looked at their improvement from pre-test to post-test. And that's what you see in this next slide. And what we found is that children who mismatched before instruction were more likely to take advantage of instruction and learn. The kids who were matchers before instruction are in white. The kids who are mismatches before instruction are in blue. The blue bar is bigger than the white bar. The mismatchers were ready to learn. Okay, is it just about conservation? No, actually it turns out to be true of many tasks. So here's a math task in America. 3 + 4 + 5 = blank + 5. Turns out that most fourth and fifth graders unfortunately can't do this problem. They find it too hard. And when they make mistakes, what they do is either they add up all the numbers on the left side of the problem and they shove that number in the blank, or they add up all the numbers in the problem and they put that number in the blank. But as we all know, because it's not that late in the day, what you're supposed to do is put 7 in the blank. You add the 3 and the 4 and ignore the 5s or cancel them out, and you get 7. Okay, so here's a kid who has added up all the numbers to the blank and says so in gesture and speech. So she added up the numbers to the equal sign in both speech and gesture. Here's another one who says exactly the same thing, but watch her hands. What she does is she first points at that 5 over there, then the other 5 and the 4 and the 3. So with her gesture, she's talking about adding up all the numbers. It's different from what she's saying.
So how did you get 12?
I added 5, and then the 4, and then the 3 too.
So she has produced a mismatch Again, we gave them all instruction. None of them knew how to solve any of these problems. And what we found is, again, the kids who were mismatchers prior to instruction were more likely to learn than the kids who were matchers. Okay, so gesturing reflects what we know. Note that it isn't just gesturing or not gesturing. They're all gesturing. It's the relationship between what they're saying in mouth and what they're saying in hand. So it really means that it isn't just waving your hands. It's important here. But it turns out that gesturing not only reflects what we know, but it can change what we know. And the way we've shown that is to manipulate gesture. Okay, so we've manipulated the gestures that children produce during learning in this math problem. And we taught one group of kids first to just say, I want to make one side equal to the other side. It's mathematical equivalence. They were told to say these words before and after solving each problem in training. There he goes.
I'll take one side equal to the other side.
Okay, Matthew, put your answer in.
The other group of kids, was taught to say exactly the same words, but also to produce some gestures. And the gesture she was taught to produce was a grouping strategy. Point at essentially the 3 and the 4 in the last problem I showed you, and then point at the blank. Here are the 3 and 2 in the blank. You can see her.
So first of all, can you say the words and do the hand movements exactly like we practiced?
I want to make one side equal to the other side.
Okay,
so we then gave them all instruction. We looked to see who learned, and what we found is that kids who were producing gestures were more likely to take advantage of the instruction than kids who didn't. Kids on the left were speech alone during training. Kids on the right were speech plus gesture. Nobody knew any of the problems to start. At the end, kids who produced gestures were more likely to learn than kids who did not produce gestures. It suggests that moving your hands is good for your mind. Okay. So, big question, why does gesturing change our minds? Why? So our thought these days is that gesture is grounded in action. This is not a very profound thought. It's very clear. Our gestures are actions. But what's really cool about gesture, I think, is that it's not only grounded in action, but it is sort of abstract. It represents things. So what gesture might be able to do is to take a learner and start him off in the concrete, but just by virtue of sort of being, having one leg in concrete and one leg in the abstract learning, it might be able to bring the child along. So what we tried to do then is to have 3 groups of children where we taught them all the same words, but we changed the nature of their movements. Either they were grounded in action or in concrete gesture or an abstract gesture. So here's an example. We taught the kids these, again, these silly little words, I want to make one side equal to the other side, and either they were taught action movements, concrete gesture, or abstract gesture. Here's the action movements. I mean, we just literally put up numbers and had them move them around. Cool, okay. Concrete gesture, she did exactly the same thing, she just didn't move the objects. But it's really the same movements. And here, this is the abstract gesture you saw before. Okay, so we trained them on these problems that had the blank plus 4. And then we tested them on problems that were exactly the same format, of course, different words. And what did we find? They all learned. No differences among the conditions, action, concrete gesture, abstract gesture. But we also gave them some transfer tasks. So we trained them on the blank plus 4, and then we gave them some problems where we had 3 plus blank. Now, if you do that, note that you can't just rotely be adding up the first 2 numbers and putting it in the blank, because you're going to get it wrong. You have to at least get this a little. And what's interesting is that action fell off. But concrete gesture was fine, and so was abstract gesture. So that all helps for learning, but for generalizing and transferring, gesture was much better. We then even took it one more step, and we took out the equal addends. So now you really have to know it's about equivalence and figure out how to do it. And what happened is that even concrete gesture is starting to fall off. So what this is suggesting is that actions are, they help children learn the problems on which they're taught, but gesturing helps children go beyond those problems and generalize. We've actually are finding recently that retention, gesture also helps you retain. And the 2 things that are really important about learning is not just learning this, but learning things that are like this, learning to extend this to other things, and also retaining it. And gesture works very well for doing this better than action. Okay, So we're now actually looking at this. I have not much to report here, but we're looking at brain mechanisms that underlie this effect using fMRI, because what we've done is, you know, the study I showed you before where the kids either produced gestures or didn't, we looked later at the learners. Now, they're not doing any movements at all later. We stick them in a scanner. We haven't solved the problems. There's no action being done. But we looked at what brain areas are activated, and it turns out if you learned using gesture, your brain areas and the motor areas are activated, and more activated than they are if you didn't learn using gesture, which sort of implicates this whole action paradigm. Action does, maybe even embodied cognition if we knew what that meant, but it does, it suggests that the body is important here. And the way in which you learn something influences how you process it way after you've learned it. Now, what we're trying to do, there are two hypotheses that might explain the learning. And one possibility is that if you're learning from action, you're learning on these particular numbers, the actions tie you to these numbers. You sort of, it's hard to pull away from those particular numbers. That means action can hurt. But the other possibility, not mutually exclusive, is that gesture is really good at pulling you away from the particular things. And so it might be really beneficial for generalizing. And we're sort of hoping that when we really get into the brain areas that are activated, we'll be able to pull apart these two hypotheses. Well, we'll see. Okay, so language is resilient. When it can't come out of the mouth, it comes out of the hands. Gesture is resilient. It comes for free along with speech and helps us think. So, last point I want to make is, you know, if gesture is so resilient, signers should do it too. Deaf people or hearing people who produce a sign language. And they do. So here's an example. We asked speakers to describe objects that were so similar that words failed them. So if I asked you to describe those two vases sitting there, you'd start ba ba ba, yellow, and then you'd start gesturing, because it's really hard to capture the differences between, you can do it, but it's hard to, and so you're likely to gesture like this guy.
Two different pumps in the middle and at the bottom.
Okay, so signers do it too. Here's a signer. It may be hard for you to see this because it's so dark, but the signers not only gesture with their hands, yeah, you saw it. They gesture with their mouths. Look at what this guy is doing to create this vase. Come on, do it again. Come on. There he goes. Can you see it? It's fabulous. And no hearing person has ever done that. I mean, in our studies, I'm sure they've. It's hard, actually. I can't even illustrate it for you. There's something about what they do, and they're very good at getting these shapes. So there's something about using hand and mouth, whatever you can, to get your ideas across. So our big question now is, does this gesturing that signers do, does it serve the same kind of cognitive function that gesture does for speakers? And answering this question actually allows us to disentangle a sticky theoretical question. And that is, you know, why does gesturing lead to change? One possibility, a very obvious one, is that it offers a second modality. This is great. You have hands, you have mouths, you have two modalities, and that's what's really important, the fact that hand and mouth are used together. The other possibility is that hand and mouth offer two different representational formats. Because language, which is coming out of the mouth for hearing people, is discrete and categorical. But gesture is much more mimetic, much more analog. It sort of paints a picture in a way that's different from language. And maybe it's the juxtaposition of those two representational formats that's really key. Well, we can't ask this question with hearing people, because, you know, that the only way they gesture is with their hands. So we can turn to signers, because signers do not use two modalities. It's all coming out of their hands. We're ignoring the mouth for the moment because I don't know what to do with that. But they do use two representational formats. So there is sign language, which is categorical and discrete and what linguists describe. And then there's also these analog gestures that they produce, that signers produce. And the question is, do signers produce gesture-sign mismatches? Is that even conceivable? And if they do, does it predict learning? Okay, so first we had to figure out what gesture was. So going back to mathematical equivalence, well, we know a lot about the gestures that children produce. And this is a deaf kid who is explaining her answers to the math problem. She got it wrong. And what she is doing is she's saying add all in sign. She does add all. She actually mouths it too. And then she points at all four numbers in the problem and gestures it. So here we go. Add. Whoop. Here's her gesture. Okay. Let me deconstruct it. It's too fast. Okay. Here she goes. So she did add all. That was her signing. And then in gesturing, she did this line under the all four, and then she punctuated each one. Okay. So that's her gestures. She produced these, or these kids produced gestures on 80% of the problems. Is that a lot or is it a little? We had no idea. So we went back to our hearing kid data, and it turns out hearing kids do it on 73% of the problems. That's good. You know, it's nice. Okay. Do they produce mismatches? So here's a mismatch. Kid still doesn't understand the problem. It's a different kid. And what she does is she talks about adding up the numbers on the equal sign and putting that answer in the blank with her signs. But then she throws in this gesture where she covers that number that's the same with her gestures as though to subtract it. And it's not the same information. So here she goes. Okay, covers. Oh, it's so fast. So here, to deconstruct it, she does add and put. That's the add to equal sign. And this is her gesture. She indicates a 7, 4, and 2, and then she covers that 7, which is really sort of an add-subtract strategy, which is a different kind of strategy. So she's produced a mismatch. All right? We looked at the proportion of kids who produced more than 3 mismatches, because that was a marker for us for the hearing kids, 42%. 35% of the hearing kids. So we're in the right ballpark here. Okay, but now the really interesting question is, does it predict learning? So what I'm going to show you next is on the x-axis, what I have is I've arrayed all of the kids as a function of how many mismatches they produced before learning. 0, before training. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and there are some kids in each bin. And then what I'm going to show you is the proportion of children in each bin who progressed after training. Before training, they solved none of the problems correctly, because that's how we selected them. After training, they had to solve at least 5 out of the 6 problems correctly to be counted on this chart. If mismatch is indicating learning, the more mismatches, the better. And so there should be more learners over there where there are 6 mismatches. And that's just what we found. It's really very pretty data suggesting that the kids who produce more mismatches were ready to learn, even though they're signers, and even though they're learning it in this other language. To put this in the same terms as before, those are the data I showed you before for hearing children, and these are the same data for the deaf kids. It's pretty much exactly the same. So what does this mean? What it means is that gesture sign mismatch predicts learning as well as gesture speech mismatch does. So what it suggests is that it's the juxtaposition of these two different representational formats. It doesn't have to be hand and mouth. That's not saying hand isn't important here, because hand is part of gesture. But it doesn't have to be hand and mouth that helps for learning. It really suggests that these two different ways of representing information might be really key in gesture's power as a learning and teaching tool. Okay. So gesture serves, the bottom line is that gesture serves the same cognitive functions for signers as it does for speakers. All right, so what I've shown you now is that language is resilient. When it can't come out of the mouth, it comes out of the hands. Gesture is resilient. It comes for free with language, sign or speech, and it helps us think. I mean, when your grandmother told you to stop moving your hands, because it made you look stupid, she was wrong. She was really wrong. It's good to move your hands. It lightens your cognitive load and it helps you learn. So, you know, that's very freeing. All right, so just to summarize, what our hands can tell us about how we talk and think. So I started off, you know, with Herodotus and whatever, evolution of language. I'm actually not trying to argue here that home sign is the first step in language evolution. Of course it isn't, because our home signers are children with modern day brains. This isn't the way language first began. But what it does show us is that if language were wiped out tomorrow, totally gone and nothing else happened to any of us, which is, of course, not very likely, but the next day, kids could start to invent language. And it would look a lot like the language we currently have. The structure of language is in us. Of course, the details differ. French differs from Spanish. But the structures of language that are really sort of fundamental are things that we bring to the situation. That isn't true of everything, mind you, because we've done studies on the home signers, adult home signers in Nicaragua, and it turns out that their ability to do number is not advanced, and they cannot do large exact numbers. So where they can invent language, they're unable to distinguish 7 from 8. They can distinguish 1 from 2, but not 7 from 8. So it isn't the case that everything in the world, number in some level, at some sense, is less resilient than languages. Okay, so what home sign can do is it tells us how much linguistic structure we ourselves, we people, bring to language learning. Now, the emergence of a sign language like Nicaraguan Sign Language or like any sign language that's growing up around the globe can tell us how learning, transmitting that system from one generation to the next, to the next, to the next, how that changes language and how it becomes more complex and into those wonderful structures that linguists like to describe. All that complexity may come about from transmission. And then finally, we've learned that gesturing is a robust part of language. If you talk, you're going to gesture, even if you're signing. And it can play a role in learning, and more importantly, in generalizing and even in retaining what we learn, which is really crucial in all of learning. And that's what we're really about. Okay, so I want to end by thanking all of my many, many collaborators. You've seen their heads appear in each one of these things. My funders, and thanking you for listening. And I'm happy to answer questions if you have any. Anybody have questions? There are people who are studying gestures, or at least signers, you know, and looking at blind signers, actually, which is getting a little bit close to what you're talking about. But what we do know, we've been looking at the gesture. So one, you know, we know that blind people can gesture. Do they gesture like native speakers? I mean, that's partly what you're asking. Do I have to see a French person's gestures in order to gesture like a French person? Because there are differences across languages, across speakers of different languages in how we gesture. So what we're looking at is speakers of, say, Turkish, they gesture differently, they gesture manner and path differently than speakers of English. And we're looking at sighted people and blind people. And if seeing the gestures really matters, then the blind people ought to differ in Turkey and in America. If, however, it's just learning the language that's relevant, then the blind people should look the same, and it turns out they look the same. So it's sort of, I don't know what role the tactile plays. I think there's Tara Edwards is somebody who's doing really lovely work on this. But I know that vision is not as important as we would have thought. It really is hooked to language, at least these kinds of gestures. There are studies, actually, of kids speaking two languages and learning the gestures of that language, right? And that's sort of relevant to this point, too. It's really it's the learning of the language that engenders those differences, to some extent. I mean, not totally. You know, there are some people are more flamboyant than others, and that can be picked up. It's not flamboyance that we're talking about, though. It's really the structure of the language. And yes, there are studies of that, and it looks like gesture goes hand in hand with the language. Not totally. We can dissociate it at times, but it does look like they acquire both language and gesture at the same time. Well, that's an interesting idea. You know, everybody gestures, so it's hard to you know, you'd have to have, I guess, an armless person as the mother, and it's hard to get people to not gesture. But I think that's a good idea, and I bet it's true. It's just going to be hard to show, I think. Yeah, it's a good point. And now, in some sense, the stuff that I've done is in contrast to and juxtaposition to all of the work on nonverbal behavior, which is really about emotion. I mean, people have just, there's eons of work showing that gesture reflects my affect, my attitude, my relationship with you. I mean, a million things like that. And so what we were trying to do is to show that in addition to that stuff, it also reflects cognition. But now I think it's time for us to go back and talk about how that's related to emotion. So for example, when you produce a mismatch, we haven't looked at the face yet. So do you show angst on your face? I mean, if people don't know they're producing mismatches. You know, a kid who produces at all in one, and there's no anxiety there that we know of. But maybe it does reflect itself on the face. And these days, what we're doing is we're putting physiology belts on the kids so that we can get a sense of sort of their inner turmoil. And it looks like, or whatever, I don't know if it's turmoil, but it does look like the kids who are mismatchers, when they're talking about math, actually show this, a different behavior, a different set of physiological symptoms than kids who are matchers, which is pretty interesting. And it suggests there may be sort of course there's an emotional hook. We just don't know what it is yet. But I think it's a good place to look. Yeah. Right, but notice that this phenomenon that I'm talking about, this mismatch, can't just be arousal, because they're all gesturing. Now, maybe the mismatching kids are more aroused, but that's not just about, you know, moving. It's about moving in a particular way in relation to what you know. But I think it probably is relevant. It just isn't the whole answer. You know, none of this is the whole answer. It's not about hands, because we know action doesn't work in exactly the same, but I bet it's a piece of it. I agree. I think it's really hard to translate to hearing parents of deaf kids. I think it's crazy in our world that we let hearing kids, we not only let them, we teach them signs, but we won't let deaf kids learn signs or learn gestures or use gestures. It hasn't, and if you can think of a way that I can get it there, I would, because I think it's very important. It's so clear that they should be allowed to use their hands. But. And in some cases, they are. I mean, bilinguals, people are learning both sign and speech. But often when kids are given cochlear implants, they are prevented from signing and prevented from gesturing, something that could really help them. So
I was hoping you would tell me something.
It's, the more it changes, the more it stays the same. Yes? I think that, yeah, that... That's such a great question, and we're just trying to struggle and figure out where it sits. I mean, I think it's sort of neither explicit nor implicit. I think it's much more implicit in some sense. But the information, and we've called the information conveyed by gesture implicit, but sometimes it matches the information conveyed in speech, and so then it's really explicit as well. But I think in some ways gesture's beauty, its real power, they come from the fact that it is implicit, and it's hooked to this explicit speech. It co-occurs with it. It's integrated temporally and all of that sort of stuff. So I think that we're really starting to think about that in a way that I hope will be productive. But I completely agree it's the right way to go, to really think about that. It's more focused. Right. That would be fabulous. I'll let you know.
Susan,
we done? Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.